And we're live, guys. Welcome to another episode of Good Morning Crypto. Only here, only on Ivan on Tech. We are, of course, broadcasting live straight out of Stockholm, Sweden. And we do this show each and every day at 8 a.m. Central European Summertime, guys. It's so good to be back, and it's so good to be back at our normal times. You know, we did a video yesterday, but that wasn't 8 a.m. Today, we're back 8 a.m. So today, we have so much to discuss. Because we will be talking about the Bitcoin war that is happening right now. And this is something that everyone should study and everyone should know. Guys, if you hold crypto and you're not aware of this war that we're entering right now, I think you might be in trouble. Because in this video, I will show you the different stages of the war between Bitcoin and the governments and where we are in the different stages and how you need to protect yourself. Because at the end of the day, you need to be ready. You need to be ready. And by the way, we do this show each and every day at 8 a.m. Central European Summertime, guys, and I come to you like an atomic clock, as I always say, like an atomic clock, and now we're back. So the different stages that we're going to discuss today are number one, honeymoon stage. Right now, we're mostly in the honeymoon stage. Number two, we're going to talk about the black market stage. We are entering in some countries, this black market stage where Bitcoin is being outlawed completely. The next stage is competition, and the last stage is surrender, when Bitcoin will win and everything else will surrender. So these are the four stages you need to keep in mind, and these are the four stages we will be talking about a lot today. Also, as you probably know, we have a new prime minister in Great Britain, and so many people are looking forward to Boris Johnson, and so many people are also trying to get Boris to adopt cryptocurrency. So this is something that we will start with. And you know, Boris is such a good name. I don't know about you guys, but when I think about Boris, I think about Boris Yeltsin and the times in the 90s when he was ruling Russia. I don't know if you have seen these dancing moves of Boris Yeltsin and really these funny videos that are online. Have you seen this? Let me show you a video from Boris Yeltsin. Yeah, so as you can see, Boris is a funny name. Everyone named Boris is probably a very entertaining and funny man. And we'll see how Boris Johnson performs against Boris Yeltsin in a dancing competition if they ever get together. But on a more serious note, we'll be talking about the fact that a lot of people actually hope that Boris Johnson will show his anarchistic side and show his libertarian side, because you know that he is a reader of libertarian literature, and he's really a follower of libertarian literature. So we will see. But looking at the markets, guys. We have extreme fear right now, and you know that markets go up and down. The markets go up and down in terms of price, but mostly in terms of emotion. And when people are greedy, usually it means that soon we will see a collapse. Just like when people got greedy at 13K, we almost went to 14K, people got extremely greedy. Now people are afraid because people think we're gonna go to 3K. Some people are very, very afraid. So it gives you kind of an indication of how people are thinking. And by the way, guys, if you are trading this market waves, you should use Bybit, because you can get $60 for free. We have a collaboration if you use the link below, and you can use leverage if you want, you can short if you want, you can do all kinds of different things. You of course need to be extremely cautious and careful with leverage, but you can do that in the description if you want. Use the Bybit link below. Looking at the markets, what do we have? Nothing really has changed, guys. We have Bitcoin at 0.77%, Ethereum at 0.96, so, you know, sub 1%. Looking at the top gainers, we do have Unlimited IP, 71%. Japan Content, once again, 20%. Man, this Japan Content is really, really pumping and dumping on a daily basis. Looking at the losers, Egregia has been performing very well during the past few months. Now it's down 7.5%. You see Clippercoin next. So yeah, nothing really has happened. But we do see the situation right now with Boris. And I saw this very interesting article called B3, B Race to 3. Boris, Bitcoin, and Britain. What is actually happening, and why is it so important? So while we haven't seen Boris perform as a dancer yet, like Boris Yeltsin, we have seen Boris reading a lot of libertarian literature. So One of the authors that he has been following is Lou Rockwell. Now, Lou Rockwell, for all of you who don't know, is a libertarian author, and he has also said previously that, I love Boris Johnson, not only because the anti-war Tory mayor of London has long been a faithful LRC reader, blah, 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 but then he is also the most funniest, most interesting article you have ever read on bike helmets, but that doesn't really matter. What matters is that he is a follower of libertarian values. And this article basically tries to convince Boris why it's so important for Great Britain, for the UK, to be a leader in crypto. And they talk about the fact that, hey, this is going to be like Amazon, eBay, Microsoft, Apple combined to the power of three. Kind of like B to the power of three is right here. Boris, Bitcoin, and Britain. Bitcoin will cut across all services, both on and offline. And that is, by the way, why crypto is so much bigger than the internet. Because the internet is only for a few privileged people in the world. Now it's getting worldwide adoption. But, I mean, for the most of its life, internet has been for this very, very small population in the world, and most services you and I use on a daily basis is also something that we're alone using. I mean, really, we're just a tiny percentage of the world population using them. Just to keep in mind. Now, Bitcoin, on the other hand, is proliferating all kinds of businesses, all kinds of sectors, and all kinds of human activities, because no human activity can be done without money, really. When we're talking about business, we're talking about pleasure, we're talking about leisure. Money is involved in each step of your daily life. So that is why Bitcoin is so much bigger than the internet and everything else we've seen. And then they talk about the fact that, you know, one of the biggest issues right now is credit card fraud. And the fact that previously, when internet was kind of a new thing and online payments were a new thing, usually you had the merchants scamming customers. But right now it's completely different. Right now, with chargebacks and credit card fraud, most of the scamming is actually happening on the consumer side. And the fact that you can pay someone, then reverse the transaction, and your bank will probably do it for you because you are their customer. And merchants do not really have a lot of protection. So this is what they're talking about. And then finally, they are talking about a scenario, the unthinkable alternative if Boris Johnson, that is, rejects Bitcoin, if he doesn't embrace Bitcoin. The unthinkable alternative, according to the author of this article, is that, you know, all expertise, training, and side effects of Bitcoin will settle in another jurisdiction, not in Great Britain and not in the UK. Kind of like with the internet. I mean, to be honest, we don't see a lot of things out of the UK that are internet-based, and not a lot compared to other European states as well. I mean, if you take Europe as a whole and you compare it to the US or Asia, we're nothing. I mean, we don't have a lot of innovation, to be honest. All of our innovation is being bought by American giants. I mean, Sweden has a lot of companies like Skype and Spotify and Minecraft and a lot of others that has been performing really well. Candy Crush, all of that is also from Sweden. But you look at a global level and you really, if you compare the numbers, Europe is falling behind a lot. So they're saying basically that, hey, otherwise, if Britain does not embrace crypto, it will become a Bitcoin flyover state. The same way it is today with social media, where the government is openly mocked and ignored, as Mark Zuckerberg did by ignoring some kind of parliamentary committee that the UK tried to bring him to. And he was just, hey guys, who are you? I don't care about you. I don't care about what you're doing. So this is very true, by the way. This is very true. But unfortunately, I think the unthinkable alternative is the more likely alternative. Because although Boris Johnson, that is, not Boris Yeltsin, is a faithful Lou Rockwell reader, he has really no incentive to do anything with Bitcoin. I mean, yes, everything here is true, what the author is writing, completely true, but at the same time, think about the power that the governments will be giving up by embracing Bitcoin. So that is why it will never happen, in my view. You will not see adoption from a government side, not at all. Even if they understand that, yes, maybe it will bring innovation, yes, maybe it will bring jobs, yes, maybe it will bring all of these great things that the author is talking about, in my view, it will never happen. It will never happen in states that have their own currencies, because the currency is such a wonderful tool for the state to control the population, to fund governmental projects. If they want, they can go to war because they can make some inflation and they can pay for the war through that. And Bitcoin is really combating all of that. And Bitcoin is making it extremely difficult to do all of that. And therefore, instead, we have this war in four stages. And I think it will happen in UK. This article, in my view, is a bit... It's a bit hopium in this that they write that this is the unthinkable alternative that UK will clamp down on Bitcoin. I think it is the likely alternative, to be honest with you. I don't like it, but I think it is the likely alternative. And so the war will be happening in four stages. And this is what we're seeing right now. The conflict we're seeing right now is in four stages, and it has been wonderfully defined previously in this article that I will show you later. They also talk about these four stages. But what I tweeted recently was the fact that, you know, the stage number one is honeymoon. What is happening in the honeymoon? Right now, all over the world, we're kind of in the honeymoon state. When you look at what the states are doing to Bitcoin and really how Bitcoin is interacting with the states, what does it mean? It means that right now they're kind of interested. They're interested in learning more. They're interested in the innovation. They're interested in trying to understand how it can be useful to them. But very quickly, they understand actually it's not very useful to them. And actually, it takes a lot of power from them. So obviously it is not something that they can support, and therefore regulation starts. So regulation is actually part of the honeymoon stage. It is not banned. I mean, anyone can use cryptocurrencies. It's not banned, but the regulation is getting stricter and stricter and stricter. You add KYC, you add AML, you add so many other things. And this is really the first stage of this great war that I'm talking about. And most of the world is in the honeymoon stage. The US is in the honeymoon stage. Europe is in the honeymoon stage. Some big countries, such as India, are now moving past this. They're moving past the honeymoon stage, and instead they're moving into the black market stage. Now, you have probably seen this. Let me see. Banning of cryptocurrency and the regulation of official digital currency bill 2019. So this is a bill that was proposed in India just last week. I did not cover it because I was traveling, but this is a very serious bill. It's not accepted yet, but it is being proposed. Basically, what they talk about is that, hey, we should ban crypto, and we should make it so that no person shall mine, generate, hold, sell, deal in, issue, transfer, dispose, or use cryptocurrency in the territory of India. Now, the question is, of course, how do you enforce it? But that doesn't really matter. The matter is to create a law that scares people away. That is what's important. How you enforce it and how you really make this practical, it's not that important at this stage. It's all about making it illegal so that people don't do anything. And then they also, later in this article, propose a 10-year jail sentence for anyone who actually goes against this law. So they also say that, you know, nothing in this act should apply to any person using technology or processes underlying the cryptocurrency for purpose of experiment, research, blah, blah, blah. But all in all, you should not mine, generate, hold, sell, deal in, issue, transfer, or dispose of cryptocurrencies. So we see now the second stage in many countries, the black market stage. What does it mean? It means that still people are using crypto, people are still using Bitcoin, but now the adoption is slowing down because probably people will not take the risk to get in jail for 10 years, and instead they will keep to fiat and they will listen to what the government says. By the way, let me know what you're drinking. As always, guys, no milk, no sugar involved in the black coffee. So this means that we still have people who really, really need Bitcoin using it, but it's way harder. It's way harder to find someone who will sell you Bitcoin. It's way harder to find someone who will buy Bitcoin from you because it's so much more difficult. And you need to do everything under the cover. And you need to be charging probably higher fees. If you're a merchant and you're doing business in the black market, your fees will be way higher than the fees we see right now because you're taking a risk. You might go to jail. So obviously you will add the premium. Silver Jaguar, fifth stage could be government's win. Right, we'll get into that. Thanks for donation. We'll get into that. Anyway, the third stage is competition. Here is where the governments realize that actually we cannot stop it. Actually, it will be so difficult for us to try to regulate it, to stop it. People are still using it. Look at the black market. They're still using it. It's impossible for us to go after crypto because people are using things such as Wasabi Wallet, where you have CoinJoin, and Wasabi Wallet basically makes it very difficult for people from the outside to see who is sending which transaction because all transactions are basically being merged into one single transaction. And who knows really who is sending money to who, because in that one single transaction, you have all inputs and then all outputs in one. And there's no way to know, you know, which input corresponds to which output, because this is not something that you can track on the Bitcoin protocol. So at the end of the day, what they will realize is that, okay, we need to compete. We need to compete with the legit crypto industry by, for example, creating our own digital coin. by, for example, trying to mine Bitcoin. And this is also something that is being described in this article right here, that, you know, it at the end of the at the end of the day, it becomes apparent that controls on points of aggregation are insufficient enforcement, and then they ban Bitcoin, they outlaw Bitcoin, they enter a black market stage, but assuming sufficient resistance, Bitcoin persists independent of Fedcoin and the digital currencies, and at this time they will try to compete as a miner. The governments will try to compete as a miner, and because everything is anonymous, nobody will know. But they will try to do, for example, a 51% attack. And 51% attack can be done by shadow mining. Let's say a government, they see Bitcoin network and they say, okay, let's try to mess this up. Let's try to get as much hash power as possible, so that we can have more hash power than the rest of the guys that are mining for real. And we will mine on our own. We will not announce our new blocks to the network, because if we do announce our blocks to the network, the difficulty will increase and our 51% attack will not work. Because you really, if you want to mess with the blockchain and mess with the transactions, you need to build up a chain that is longer than the real blockchain. And you do that by mining on your own. You do not announce blocks, not to increase difficulty. You mine faster than the real blockchain. Then you announce your fake blockchain because it is now longer. It will replace the real blockchain, and you can, for example, double spend. And if you do not want to do shadow mining, you can still mess with the network by centering transactions, because you have most of the miners, and most miners are controlled by you, meaning that you can tell all of them never accept transactions from this and this and this address. While it is still probabilistically possible to get your transaction in, because some other miner might be elected block producer because they have found the proof of work solution the fastest, still you can efficiently to some extent central transaction. So they could try to do that, and this is really the third stage of the war that we're seeing, competition. The fourth stage is, though, when nothing is working, when nothing is really going their way, they will probably surrender and they will probably embrace crypto because nothing else is working. And then the whole status quo will change, and then the whole system and the establishment of how finance works, how currencies work, will also change. But another possible reality is that simply we enter stagnation. You realize that, you know, black market, which is number two, competition, which is number three. I mean, this might take years. This might take years and years and years. So really, we're really looking at a very long timeline. Another important thing is that we might enter, for example, competition, and then the government sees, okay, we have kind of killed Bitcoin, so now we can stop competing with our own miners, and we can go back to stage two, only black market. So, you know, these stages can also shift. It doesn't mean that we go 1, 2, 3, 4. We could go to 1, 2, 3, then back to 2, then back to 3, then back to 1. Maybe they decide, let's do it again and let's make it legal. So we might bounce from one stage to another. So just realize that. We have a message from Nick Carter, which is, of course, a famous influencer on Twitter, saying that we're getting closer to the black market phase. And of course, he's talking about the US and the Western world, US and Europe. And here is how you protect yourself. Because as you see in the title, I tell you, you need to protect yourself. How can you protect yourself? The only way to protect yourself is to hold your own private keys. I mean, remember, so many companies will fall victims to these different stages of the war. Your exchange might be shut down in stage number two. And who knows what will happen to the Bitcoin in that exchange? Will government seize those Bitcoins? Will government in another jurisdiction seize your Bitcoin that you have on that exchange? And does that government of that other jurisdiction respect your rights to your Bitcoin? Because you're not even a citizen in their country, so why should they respect your rights and give back to you your Bitcoin? Maybe if you have a lot of money, you can drive the legal process and you can make it so that you are respected. But honestly, nobody will respect you otherwise. I mean, this is just the default mindset to have, that nobody will really respect your rights. So think for yourself and do not rely on the fact that maybe somebody somewhere in another country who is handling the liquidation of an exchange, because now all exchanges are banned, will respect you as a hodler, especially when you see crypto cryptocurrencies being banned and cryptocurrencies being illegal. I mean, will they even give the money back to hodlers? Who knows? I'm just, you know, this is kind of a dark future that I'm talking about, but still, be prepared. I'm prepared. Are you prepared? So just take responsibility for your family, for your funds and everything else, because this is not an impossibility in the near future when you see governments really realizing that Bitcoin is not helping their own game. It's not helping them at their own game. So you need to control your own private keys. Do not trust any exchange. Do not trust that you will be somehow compensated. Only you can help yourself. And this is really what I wanted to talk about mainly today. The four stages and also the protection that you need to be thinking about. Also, you know, it's quite interesting because I found out a few months ago that I'm in this book by George Gilder. You know, he is a very famous author and he writes a lot about blockchain nowadays. And apparently I am in his book Life After Google. So while I knew that, I never told anyone on my channels, but I'm actually pretty proud of it because this guy is famous and many people listen to him. So apparently in his book, you can read the following, that hey, as the blockchain developer Ivan Liliqvist comments on his blog Ivan on Tech, it would be cool if I can program the transaction framework and say that I want to be paid in micropayments for every operation that is executed when the software is used. So basically what he's talking about is a very old video of mine. I mean, this is the video I did maybe in 2017, where I talked about the fact that with blockchain, you can have micropayments and you can also make it so that when I develop a framework that you use in your software, I can be part of your revenue model. Basically, when you use my functions and when you use my code, I can get paid. So this is what he's talking about in his book. And yeah, I'm very honored that he mentioned me and my content. Also, a bit of topic. This is not about crypto, but it is about business. And some people are asking me about books. I know I shared some books in the past that I've read and many of you appreciated it and you read them as well. So I thought, hey, I will share another book that I recently read. And this one is called Blitz Scaling. I mean, this one really blew my mind. It has nothing to do with crypto, except it does. Except it does. Let me tell you about Blitz Scaling. Basically, this is a book by Reid Hoffman, the creator of LinkedIn. And he's talking about how different companies go from zero to billion-dollar companies with, you know, worldwide users, with worldwide markets. I mean, it's so mind-blowing, the things he taught me in this book. And, you know, books are, I mean, you never know when you find something in a book that really can transform your mind. You know, you pay, what is it, like $15 for a book, you might find the tips that will bring you millions, if not billions, in the book. So that's why I always read. But he talked about Airbnb, Facebook, how they really prioritize scaling in front of efficiency. You don't want to be efficient. You just want to reach the global market. In one way, it reminds me of Bitcoin, because Bitcoin is highly inefficient in so many different ways. Look at the transaction speed. Look at everything that is happening with the block limit and, you know, the fees and so on and so forth. But the thing is, we don't have to be efficient. We need to go worldwide and we need to go fast. We need to go extremely, extremely fast. So this is something that I recommend everyone to read. Definitely read more books. And let me know what you're reading, by the way. Maybe if you read a good book, let us know in the chat, because I am interested in more. I'm interested in more good books. So this is another thing I had off topic. What else do I have? I mean, I have so many other things as well. What is this? So I found this yesterday, the fact that, you know, ATMs that are dealing in Bitcoin sometimes hide their fees and they do a spread instead. So just be aware of that. If somebody says they have zero fees, or if somebody says that they have very low fees, just keep in mind that their Bitcoin price might actually be not the real market Bitcoin price. Another thing that is off topic is this Norwegian thing. Of course, it's not off topic, but it's off topic from the things that we just discussed previously. So, you know, the Norwegian airline, apparently Their CEO and really their Norwegian business manager Bjørn Kjus or Schus, I'm not sure how to pronounce it, but he is investing in Bitcoin a lot and they will be launching their own crypto exchange. Very interesting, extremely, extremely interesting, because this is how we might actually see a lot of adoption. And I think, yeah, so Bjørn Kjus is either the founder of Norwegian or son of the founder. Anyway, this is the Kjus or Schus family that is running Norwegian. So they will be launching a crypto exchange, so keep an eye on that. And apparently you will be able to pay for it, for your flights with it. So that is all, guys. What is happening in the chat? Bring the chat to me. bring the chat to me. Ivan, are you a blockchain developer? Good question. So what we do, I mean, we are a tech company. So we do advise projects. We do advise projects on the technical level. So the latest one was Resistance, where we advise them on how to build out their infrastructure. Also, we do have our academy. Go to academy.iwantech.com if you want to learn how to program smart contracts on your own, how to program on Ethereum, on EOS, and on other platforms. You don't have to know anything. You can learn everything from scratch. We teach you programming from scratch. You don't have to know any programming at all. Of course, my past is in software. This is really how I entered the crypto space. You watch my earliest videos on the channel, it was about programming. But then I discovered that, hey, crypto is actually where I give the most value, and this is why it's all crypto now. But from the beginning, it was actually about software. But day to day, I do not develop. Day to day, I create the academy. I teach people how to develop. I advise, I consult, I know a lot about the technology, so I can consult a lot and I can teach people how they should be using blockchain. But if I'm a blockchain developer, we hire blockchain developers at the end of the day, because there's so much else to do in our business. But originally, yes. I think you need to start as a developer in order to understand this. Swedish cannot speak Norwegian. Yeah. So, I mean, I understand Norwegian, but when it comes to this, how to pronounce KJ, we don't have that in Swedish, like KJ. So, either Qs or shoes or something. Toshi Times. Yes, we do have that as well. The Creature from... Yes, you should absolutely read that book as well. Thanks for the recommendation. Ivan, if no Bitcoin accepted by governments, what about smart contract projects like Chainlink? So it is a cryptocurrency still. So I'm not sure what you mean. It's an Oracle platform for smart contracts. So what about that? Smart contracts are inherently crypto. If you're talking about Hyperledger or something, it might not have to do with crypto, but then it's just a database. Like it's not a lot different from the database. Ivan, yeah man, some people think that. Let me know if you think that. That's very interesting. Q's shoes, yeah. So you see, in Swedish we do have SJ, and it's like you know, the number 7 is SJ U, and you pronounce it who, not like SU or something. So we do have SJ, but not KJ. How is the crypto market in Sweden? I'm non-existent. Really, very small. You do have a few guys. You do have these guys, BTCX. I like them. I know the founder very well. Now he's no longer working, but Christian Ander really founded BTCX. You have Safello. Safello is very interesting because they really started as BTCX, but then they forked. So there is this drama that, you know, Safello stole the code from BTCX and so forth. I really don't want to go deep into the drama, but there is Safello as well, if you want to use it in Sweden. There is this guy Striu, but they haven't launched for so long. Where are they? Triu Exchange. Yeah. See, they are... Oh, now it's blocked even. Okay, you cannot even enter it. I guess they're launching now because they have been launching for so much time. Also, you have Nova Exchange. And Nova Exchange is, by the way, operated by BTCX, so it's the same guys. Nova Exchange is really exchange for exotic assets. I mean, look at this. I mean, shout out to Oscar. Usually the CEO of this exchange watches my stream. Shout out to Oscar. But man, you have some fantastic coins. You have I0C, IXC. There was this coin called Piggy Coin. Let's see if this... Yeah, they have Piggy Coin, guys. They have... this is really the exotic of the most exotic of the most exotic assets in the world. Sativa, Troll Coin. Insane. Complete... Anyway, these guys are Swedish. From the beginning, it was interesting with Nova that was that from the beginning they were incorporated in Ethiopia. So the Swedish guy, and this is another Swedish guy, a Swedish guy actually founded this exchange and he incorporated it in Ethiopia. And then they took it back to Sweden and now it's a Swedish exchange. So guys, this was an amazing day to hang out with you. I hope you enjoyed it. MM Crypto, nice. Shout out to Chris from MM Crypto. hit the likes, as Robin Hannon says. Absolutely do that. Do not forget. Also, share the stream. Absolutely, right now, go share it and smash the bell. Maybe the most important thing you can do right now is smash that bell. Also, join Telegram in the description right now so you don't miss anything. And finally, also, don't forget our collaboration with Bybit. You get $60 if you sign up and deposit 0.2 Bitcoin or 6 Ethereum. Do not miss the opportunity. Go right now and you have to use the link below. Really, it takes 60 seconds, you get $60. 60 seconds. $60. I really like it. I heard it, by the way, on MM Crypto. Shout out to you, Chris. I really like the slogan. 60 seconds for $60. So definitely do that. Anyway, guys, I see you all tomorrow at 8 a.m. Central European Summertime, guys. Have a great, great day, and goodbye, guys. Goodbye, goodbye, goodbye.